Three is a magic number. Yes, it is. It's a magic number. Somewhere in the ancient mystic trinity, you get three as a magic number. The past and the present and the future, faith and hope and charity, the heart and the brain and the body give you three as a magic number.
Good morning, church. Welcome to LargsNaz Online this Trinity Sunday. And it's not only Trinity Sunday, it's also a very special day for a couple of folks that we love a whole lot. Pastor Steve's parents, Reverend Charles and Louise Fountain. And we know they're watching because they watch every Sunday. Today is their 69th wedding anniversary. Happy anniversary, Mom and Dad. We love you and we miss you a lot. We are so glad all of you have joined with us this morning. Welcome again to LargsNaz Online. There are some really exciting things happening at LargsNaz these days. Our brand new boiler and our new radiator upstairs are installed, and we really appreciate the work of all the volunteers that have been hard at work this week trying to get the sanctuary back up and running and ready, and also to get things ready for the LargsNaz Cafe brunch next Sunday. Now, before I talk about that, I do want to remind you that although we are not meeting for worship on Sundays just yet, we are meeting for prayer on Wednesdays at 10 a.m. in the church and on Zoom. We're also meeting together for our monthly Bible studies, our second helping Bible study. In fact, there's one tonight. Now, as you know, space in the sanctuary is very limited, and so we need you to let us know if you're coming so that we can set things up and make sure there's room for everybody. So if you haven't let us know about tonight's second helping at 6 p.m., please give us a call or text us and let us know. You can also send us an email. Now, as mentioned last week, our building at 21 Aiken Street is not only a place of worship, it's also a registered and certified hospitality venue, and it can be used for either of those things. But the way current restrictions are, it can't be both at the same time. And so, as a hospitality venue, we have decided that the LargsNaz Community Cafe will begin serving a weekly set menu Sunday brunch on June 6th at 11 a.m. So you'll be able to reserve a table for up to six people from three households under the current guidelines. And just as other cafes, you'll need to wear a face covering when you're not seated, and you'll need to adhere to the 1 meter social distancing. The brunch will take place starting at 11 a.m. until 1, so you'll need to come at 11, and we'll have room for 28 diners. It'll also be helpful for us if, when you call to make your reservation, you know who those households are that are going to be seated at your table. Now, if you don't know or you don't mind sitting with whoever we assign you to sit with, then we can make those arrangements and maybe you can meet somebody new. And so we'll also have a few smaller tables available if needed. Now, there are three items to choose from on the menu this week, and it's going to change from week to week. So this week you can choose from either scrambled eggs on toast or a yogurt parfait. That's a sweetened yogurt with a berry compote layered and then homemade granola on the top. Or the third menu choice is my absolute favorite, and that is porridge. Now, you could also have a fruit compote or syrup on your porridge if you like it sweetened in that way. Brunch is served with either tea or coffee, and it comes with brown toast, Pastor Steve's scrumptious banana bread. Many of you tried that. It's delicious. And then also a walnut fudge. The cost for the brunch is £4. I do hope that you can join us next week. If you'd like to make a reservation, please give us a call. We need your reservations in by Wednesday of this week. That's Wednesday, the 2nd of June, to hold a spot. The number to call is my cell, 0756-897-7311. As we continue to worship together, we welcome you to the LargsNaz online worship service, and we encourage you to join in and spend some time with each other and with our Lord and Savior this morning. Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you for the beauty and wonder of your creation. Help us to love and respect all that you've made, to share your gifts with our brothers and sisters in need, and to protect and nurture all that is fragile and vulnerable on this earth. Loving God, we thank you for the huge diversity of people who share this world. We pray for a renewed spirit of longing for peace and reconciliation wherever there is conflict, injustice, and oppression. Help us to do what we can to bring peace into our own lives and to seek your ways of peace for the welfare of all your children. Loving God, we thank you for the love and fellowship of friends and families. Help us to be generous with our time, with our love, and with ourselves to care for all who are lonely and in need of our support. Loving God, we thank you for all who work to improve care and treatment of those who are physically ill or mentally distressed. We pray that your loving and healing presence will surround all who are suffering today, and that your Holy Spirit will comfort and uphold them throughout their troubles. Loving God, we offer you our prayers, trusting in your love. You will use them and us for the fulfillment of your purpose for your creation. Give us courage to be part of your answer to prayer. And when you ask, whom shall I send? Free us from fear, that we may answer, here am I, send me. Amen.
resolve no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have allured my sight. And I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. And I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to count all his losses so that I may gain Christ. Sharing his suffering, sharing his raising, granted a brand new life. And I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
Romans 8:12 through 17. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but when you have received a spirit of adoption. Let's start that over. Romans 8:12 through 17. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. This is the written word of God for the people of God.
Good morning, church, and happy 69th anniversary to my parents, Charles and Louise Fountain. It is good to have you all with us this morning, and it's good to have every one of you with us this morning on this Second Helping Sunday. We'll be meeting tonight at the church for our Second Helping Bible Study at 6 p.m., and we'll also be on Zoom, but if you're joining us at the church, remember to let us know because space is limited. Now, today is what we call Trinity Sunday. That's the Sunday after Pentecost, and after which we enter a long period of ordinary time on the church calendar, a period of ordinary time that stretches all the way to Advent, which begins on the 28th of November this year. As Bob Dylan said, the times, they are a-changing. You know, Bob Dylan turned 80 years old this week, by the way. But I'll tell you, even though we call that period from now until the end of November ordinary time, it need not be simply ordinary or boring or mundane. And in fact, I think that in 2021, ordinary time is going to be extraordinary. I believe that in our ordinary time, we are not simply going to see a return to the way things used to be or to a new normal. I believe that we're going to see things happening beyond what we could ask for or even imagine. And I hope you're as excited as I am to see what God has in store for our church, for the church in our community, and all across the world. Extraordinary times are ahead of us, and even though this can be a time of uncertainty and anxiety for some, we need not have any fear of the future if we are led by the Spirit. Now, next Sunday, as you heard Pastor Tasha mention, the LargsNaz Community Cafe will begin serving its weekly Sunday brunch at 11 a.m. at the church. And here in the online worship service, we'll be following suit by starting a new sermon series called Food for Thought. And it'll run for 6 weeks until the middle of July, and in which we'll be looking at several passages of Scripture that one way or another involve food. And there's an awful lot to choose from. In the Bible, there are feasts and famines, there's forbidden fruit and the Last Supper, there's manna from heaven, and there are dinner parties and miracles involving the feeding of multitudes, and there are plenty of parables about growing food, and we can't cover all of them in just 6 weeks, so you'll want to be sure and join us to find out which ones we do talk about. I'm sure you'll find this series edifying and satisfying. Food for Thought, starting next week. But today is Trinity Sunday, a day when in the church we celebrate the Christian doctrine of the Trinity, the idea that God is triune, that there are three persons of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, the doctrine of the Trinity is one of those theological subjects that seem a little scary to some folks. And that fear is understandable because it's easy to get bogged down in the details. You know, the history of the doctrine of the Trinity is full of discussion and debate about how the three persons function and what their essence or the stuff they're made of is. And one of the early debates about the Trinity took place in the year 325 at the Council of Nicaea. That's where we got the Nicene Creed. And that debate was about whether the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit were made up of the same substance or of similar substance. Now, the Greek for those two terms is homoousios, that means same substance, and homoiousios, that means similar substance. And the council decided that the three persons are made up of the same substance, homoousios, and not of similar substance, homoiousios. Now, you might think that that's an awful nitpicky distinction to have a debate over, and I guess you'd be right about that. But if you said there's not one iota of difference between homoousios and homoiousios, then you'd be wrong about that, because if you look closely at the difference between those two words, it's that Greek letter I, and that's called an iota. And that may be where we get the expression not one iota's difference from, the Council of Nicaea and their debate over the doctrine of the Trinity. But that's a good example of the way that a discussion about the Trinity can get bogged down in details and specifics. And if we're not careful, sometimes theological discussions can get in the way of the proclamation of the gospel. You know, as I was preparing for today's sermon, I came across some good advice. Now you might be surprised to hear it, but I do look at commentaries and preaching notes and guides, and in one of the preaching guides I was reading this past week, a very wise instructor had this to say to preachers getting ready to preach today. They said, it is not the task of the preacher on Trinity Sunday to explain the Trinity. Resist the urge to find the perfect metaphor to explain God in a way that satisfies everyone listening, it won't work. All our metaphors reduce the immensity of God into something comprehensible and therefore something less than the true nature of God. Now that's a powerful reminder, isn't it? All our efforts to say the Trinity is like this are going to fall short because the Trinity isn't like anything else. The majesty and mystery of the triune God, the creator God, who, though eternal, stepped into history and took on flesh and blood and emptied himself even to death on a cross, and by the power of the Spirit was raised up again. That's not something you can find a simple metaphor for, because that's not something that's like anything else. And even though we may search for ways to describe it, they are always less than perfect, and we're driven to find another and another and another. You know, there's a cartoon on YouTube. It's been there for almost 10 years now, and it's been viewed well over a million times, and it makes the rounds on social media every now and then, especially around St. Patrick's Day and Trinity Sunday, but it was produced by the folks at Lutheran Satire, and in this cartoon, two 5th century Irish villagers are talking to St. Patrick, and they ask him to explain the doctrine of the Trinity, but they remind him that they are simple people. They don't have the theological training or the education that he has, so he'll need to keep it simple. Well, St. Patrick tries to explain, and they don't get it. And so he uses some analogy, some metaphor, some ways of saying, well, the Trinity is like this or like that. But each time St. Patrick tries to use an analogy like the Trinity is like the way water can be ice or liquid or vapor, or like the way the sun produces heat and light, each time Patrick uses an analogy, the two villagers point out the way that it represents some heretical view like Arianism or modalism. Turns out that the two villagers know more theology than they let on. And finally, Patrick gets so frustrated that he just rattles off a detailed and complicated creedal statement about the Trinity, and the two villagers say, oh, well, why didn't you just say that to start with? It's pretty funny, and I've edited it down to only 2.5 minutes, so I thought I'd share it with you.
Okay, Patrick, tell us a bit more about this Trinity thing.
Yeah, Patrick, tell us.
But remember that we're simple people without your fancy education and books and learning, and we're hearing about all of this for the first time. So try to keep it simple, okay, Patrick?
Yeah, real simple, Patrick.
Sure, there are three persons of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, yet there is only one God.
Don't get what you're saying here, Patrick.
Not picking up what you're laying down here, Patrick.
Could you use an analogy, Patrick?
Sure. The Trinity is like water, and how you can find water in three different forms, liquid and ice and vapor.
That's modalism, Patrick!
What?
Modalism, an ancient heresy confessed by teachers such as Noetus and Sibelius, which espouses that God is not three distinct persons, but that he merely reveals himself in three different forms. This heresy was clearly condemned in Canon 1 at the First Council of Constantinople in 381 AD, and those who confess it cannot rightly be considered a part of the Church Catholic. Come on, Patrick!
Yeah, get it together, Patrick!
Then the Trinity is like the sun in the sky, where you have the star and the light and the heat.
Oh, Patrick.
Come on, Patrick. That's Arianism, Patrick.
Arianism?
Yes, Arianism, Patrick. A theology which states that Christ and the Holy Spirit are creations of the Father and not one in nature with him. Exactly like how heat and light are not the star itself, but are merely creations of the star.
All right, sorry. The Trinity is like this three-leaf clover here.
I'm gonna stop you right there, Patrick.
Yeah, hold your horses, Patrick.
You're about to confess partialism.
Partialism?
Yes, partialism, a heresy which asserts that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are not distinct persons of the Godhead, but are different parts of God, each composing one-third of the divine.
All right, I'll try again. The Trinity is like how the same man can be a husband and a father and an employer.
Modalism again.
All right, then it's like the three layers of an apple.
Partialism revisited.
Fine, the Trinity is a mystery which cannot be comprehended by human reason, but is understood only through faith and is best confessed in the words of the Athanasian Creed, which states that we worship one God in Trinity and Trinity in unity, neither confusing the persons nor dividing the substance, that we are compelled by the Christian truth to confess that each distinct person is God and Lord, and that the deity of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is one, equal in glory, co-equal in majesty.
Well, why didn't you just say that, Patrick?
Yeah, quit beating around the bush, Patrick.
We will not be explaining the doctrine of the Trinity today. We can certainly dive deep into that subject at tonight's Bible study, but this morning there will be no searching for the perfect metaphor, the simplest analogy with which to illustrate it, nor will we be dissecting the daunting theological minutiae of the substance and function of the three persons of the Godhead. So there's no need to fear. However, I believe that we will see that we cannot think about what the Apostle Paul is saying in the six verses in the eighth chapter of his epistle to the Romans without thinking about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And as we consider what Paul had to say to the church in Rome, and to the church today, I believe we will come away with a deeper understanding of how Jesus and God the Father and the Holy Spirit work, what the triune nature of God means, what it really means for each of us as individuals and all of us as the church, as we respond to the call of the good news of the gospel, as we live by faith. So let's begin at the beginning of our scripture for today. In verse 12, Paul writes, "So then, brothers and sisters," now let's back up right there. The Greek that is translated as "so then" here in the NRSV is translated as "therefore" in the NIV. The Greek word is "ara," and it's a word that's used after describing a situation and before pointing to a conclusion. In logic, it might be used in a syllogism. That's an argument like this: all people are mortal. Socrates is a person. Therefore, ara, so then, Socrates is mortal. Or another everyday example: I'm hungry. There's food in the fridge. Ara, therefore, I'm going to get something out of the fridge and eat it. So Paul is about to present the conclusion that follows the premises that he has laid out previously. And so he uses the word ara, therefore. My friend, Pastor David Gallimore, says that any time we see the word therefore used in Scripture, we ought to find out what it's there for. That is, we ought to see what Paul has said just before he uses the word therefore. We ought to find out the basis of the conclusion he has come to. And if we look in the verses preceding verse 12 in chapter 8, if we go back to the beginning of chapter 8, verse 1, we read, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Therefore, it's that word ara again. Paul is drawing a conclusion based on what he has said previously, before chapter 8. And if we look back before this chapter, we find again and again that Paul says ara, therefore, so then. And as we go back through the verses and chapters, through chapter 7, chapter 6, chapter 5, and 4, and 3, and 2, and all the way back to chapter 1, because in today's passage of Scripture, Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 12, Paul is still making an argument that he began at the very beginning of the epistle. And way back there, after his introduction, he says in verses 16 and 17 of chapter 1, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed through faith for faith. As it is written, the one who is righteous will live by faith." And for seven chapters, Paul has been building layer upon layer of premises and conclusions. So we see therefore, and verse after verse, as he expands upon the idea that the righteous will live by faith and explains to the church what living by faith is all about. And all of those layers have brought us to verse 12 in chapter 8, where Paul says, "So then, ara, therefore, brothers and sisters, we are debtors. We are obligated not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. We have no obligation to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live." Now, just for a little while, I want to think about how what Paul is saying here in verses 12 and 13 is connected to what he has been saying for the seven chapters before this, and then we'll move on to the other verses in today's scripture. And I want to talk about verses 12 and 13 and the verses that follow by highlighting three words. Today is Trinity Sunday, after all, so three is the order of the day, and each of these words begin with the letter F. And the first is this: flesh. Paul tells us here in verse 12, you are debtors not to the flesh. You are not obligated to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. And living according to the flesh is contrasted with living in the Spirit. Paul says, if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you'll live. Now, we said that for the past seven chapters, Paul has been expanding on what it means to live by faith. And living by faith, he said again and again, is contrasted with living by works. But here in verse 12 of chapter 8, Paul contrasts the life in the Spirit with living according to the flesh. And it's important to notice here that living according to the flesh is not only living according to one's sinful nature. It's not only being driven by or in bondage to our appetites and desires, being selfish and in sin, simply living to satisfy the fleshly nature. But you'll notice also that Paul talks about the law of sin and death. So that living according to the flesh, as opposed to living according to the Spirit, doesn't refer only to being driven by sin and not caring about righteousness. It can also refer to the bondage that one can be under who tries to earn one's righteousness by living up to the letter of the law, because it can't be done. It's like searching for the perfect metaphor for the Trinity. It is an endless quest, and that's particularly true when the law is filtered through authorities like the Pharisees, who have little interest in worship and a lot of interest in distinguishing themselves from those who are unclean or unlawful. And Paul had been one of those zealous persecutors who made it his business to find those who weren't living up to the letter of the law and get rid of them. We still have folks who think and act like Pharisees in the church today, unfortunately. And so Paul reminds the church, that what happens through Jesus and the work of the cross fulfills the law, so that we're no longer in bondage to it, but we can walk in the Spirit rather than in the flesh. We are under grace, not the law of sin and death. Now, does that mean that we're free to sin as we please? Not at all, Paul says at the beginning of chapter 6, but what it does mean, is that we do not follow the law or do good works or love our neighbors so that God will love us, but because God loves us. We don't do good so that we may be forgiven and righteous and holy. We do good because we're forgiven and righteous and holy. And Paul goes on to say here in chapter 8 that because we live according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh, we need not fall into fear. Verse 15, "For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear." And that's our second F, fear. We need not fall back into the fear that we are not doing the right things, the things that we need to do to earn our salvation, the fear that we're not trying hard enough, or that God is out to condemn us if we don't prove that we're worthy or deserving of his love. No, we don't have a spirit of bondage or slavery or fear because we're not led by our own wills, by our own attempts at righteousness, by our own strength and our own works our own flesh. We are led by the Spirit, who leads us on the path that's right as we surrender to God's will. And when we are led by the Spirit, we need not fear. Back in South Carolina, on the South Carolina District, the Nazarene Campground is located in Batesburg. That's a little town known for not much more than chicken houses and the Nazarene Campground. But anyway, at the Nazarene Campground, there's a lake and a tabernacle, and a dining hall and a ball field and swimming pool. And there are dormitories and lots of little cabins that are owned by various families from all over the district. And every summer, families from all over the state come and stay in their cabins or in the dorm at what they call family camp. And there are special services all throughout the day and into the night, and meals together and so on, activities, sort of like North Break here in the UK, except much hotter, much, much hotter and more humid. And oh, the smell of chicken houses in the heat and humidity of a South Carolina summer, that's an unforgettable aroma. Well, many years ago, decades now, I guess, family camp was going on at the campground, and there was one particular family who were staying in their cabin for the week, and they had a teenage daughter. And she was staying in the cabin with her parents and her grandparents and her little brother. And late one night, after all the services and the fellowship was over and everyone was either asleep or close to it, this teenage girl, she was a young teenager, probably about 15 or so, she decided that she would take a stroll around the campground. She wasn't up to anything. She just wanted some alone time. And so she set out and spent some time meandering in the moonlight all by herself. She walked down by the lake and crossed the ball field. She crossed the road to where the new dorms were, and she was headed up the road, up a big hill to where the swimming pool would eventually be built. I'm not sure if it had been built at that point. But as she was walking along the side of that road in the dark by herself, a golf cart drove up behind her and pulled over beside her. And there were a couple of adults in the golf cart, one of whom was the district superintendent. And they asked her what she was doing. And she told them she was just out for a walk in the night air. And that's when they told her that it was getting pretty late. And so they said, "You need to get on back to your cabin." And she didn't blink or miss a beat. She said, "No, I don't. Do you know who my daddy is?" She had no fear. In the first place, she wasn't doing anything wrong. And in the second place, she was Mark Allison's daughter. Now, I don't know exactly what happened right after that, but I do know that the story of that fearless girl who said, "Do you know who my daddy is?" has been told many times since then. And every now and then, that little girl's daddy will ask someone, "Do you know who my daughter is?" But my point is that she was unfazed by her situation. Even in the darkness, even in the face of the power of the authority, she had no fear, because she knew that she was part of her father's family. And that's our last F word, family. And that's what the Apostle Paul is reminding the church in Rome about. He's saying, "Do you know who your daddy is? Do you remember that you are joint heirs with Jesus? You're led by the Spirit, and all who are led by the Spirit are children of God. And children of God do not have a spirit of fear, but a spirit of adoption." And as any adoptive parent knows, that idea of adoption does not in any way mean something less than or secondary to biological offspring. In fact, Paul's language emphasizes this fact. In verse 3 of chapter 8, Paul writes that God the Father sent his own son. His own son. The root of that word that Paul uses there is huios. It means a son or a descendant. So Jesus is the huios of God. And in verse 15, when Paul says that we have the spirit of adoption, The word there is huiothesia. Thesia, to make, and huios, a descendant, just like Jesus is. The implication is that the relationship to the Father is the same, that of a huios, just as Jesus is. Not a slave, not a servant, not a stranger or even a friend, but a son or a daughter of God the Father Almighty. Paul is clear about the implications of this relationship in verse 16 when he writes that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. But lest we get to feeling too entitled or arrogant because we're sons and daughters of the Father, the Most High, the Everlasting, before we get to thinking, I'm an heir, a descendant, that means I have an inheritance coming. That means I don't have to do anything but enjoy the benefits of my status and wait to get what's mine. No. Paul reminds us that there is sacrifice required of those who are living by faith. Paul writes that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may be also glorified with him. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. There is the promise of glory, but there is also the suffering with Jesus. There's an English word that means to suffer with, and it's compassion. Passion means to suffer. That's the word we use when we talk about the passion of Christ. And Paul is pointing out here that to live by faith, to be led by the Spirit, to be a joint heir with Jesus, is to live a life of compassion, a life that is wholly given over to the self-sacrificing example of the love of God poured out for the world. Paul says in verse 15, when we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. That phrase, Abba, Father, has nothing to do with a Swedish pop group. It's a term of endearment, of tenderness. Endearment, a way of saying Papa or Daddy. And it's no coincidence that it is what Jesus cries out as he faces the terrifying prospect of trial and torture and crucifixion, as he faces the passion, the suffering in the Garden of Gethsemane in Mark 14:36. Abba, Father, take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Paul is telling the church that we too have that kind of intimacy, that kind of relationship with God the Father as well, where we are led by the Spirit even when we are in places of uncertainty and vulnerability. When we suffer with Jesus. We have compassion for those for whom Jesus suffered. And even when the future looks scary, even dangerous, even threatening, we need not fear because we are joint heirs with Jesus. We are living by faith. We are part of the family of the Father. I remember being in the open air tabernacle at that campground in South Carolina for so many worship services. Those old wooden pews would be packed and the huge fans would be blowing that sultry evening air around, and as we sang, the voices and the music would fill the sticky stillness of the night with celebration and praise. And one of the songs I remember singing so often was a song by Bill and Gloria Gaither. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joint heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod, for I'm part of the family. The family of God. Are you part of the family of God this morning? You can be. The invitation is open to every single one of us. Because of the sacrifice of the Son, we can be led by the Spirit and become the children of the Father. We can face the future, whatever it holds, without anxiety or alarm. We can say to the world, to the principalities and powers, to the storms and sufferings, to the trials and temptations, do you know who my daddy is? There are exciting and challenging and surprising days ahead for the church, extraordinary times, as we live by faith and hold fast to the promise that there is no fear for the Father's family.
Trusting confide.
just as God's word was sent into the world to heal and redeem, so God sends you into the world this day to be light and love, healing and hope. Go now to be light for the world, and may the grace and peace of God, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer, come upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God. Praise Him, all creatures here.